You are watching DHTV from California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Okay, the late 18th and early 19th centuries witnessed what historians refer to as the Age of Revolution. These were attempts by people in Europe and the Western Hemisphere to implement constitutional forms of government. And basically, people who had experienced increased wealth stemming from the trade in goods originating in Europe's colonial empires wanted equal footing with the feudal nobility. People were becoming, quote unquote, enlightened with ideas about representative government. And so they began to question the rights that rulers reserved for themselves ever since the famous Magna Carta had been implemented in England. And the most famous enlightened political philosopher was Jean-Jacques Rousseau, who introduced the notion of representative government, that a government that could ensure people would be guaranteed rights, especially their right to the ownership of property. And he challenged the notions of rulers guaranteeing themselves rights while bestowing privileges on certain elements of the commoner class. This enlightened discourse met stiff resistance from the nobility. In essence, anti-democratic forces are always trying to subvert people's rights. In doing so, they spark revolution. Now, in Europe, feudalism had gone through many stages of violent upheavals and attempts to create order on the continent. Warlord kings for centuries kept populations living in fear through the use of violence. Other entities ruled through theocratic states, using religion as a means to maintain a complacent population. And what became unique about the feudal system were its numerous attempts to stop the violence by entering into contracts of mutual obligations. And this is why the Magna Carta is so important to understand historically, because it is the first document that guarantees the rights of the wealthy to the ownership of their property. The nobility challenged warlord kings and theocratic states. In essence, feudalism became a system for the rich. So when Europe expanded its reach to the Western Hemisphere, over time, the wealth that was generated from the colonies created new classes of people who began to challenge the system. And as the French, the British, and the Spanish fought to seize control of ever more resources in the Americas, people in the colonies began to question European attempts to keep their wealth in check. Hence, movements for change characterized the era between 1760 and 1830 in the Western Hemisphere. And this was known as the Age of the Revolutions. It begins with the American Revolution in 1776. It moves to the French Revolution in the 1790s. And then it explodes with the Haitian Revolution in 1801, followed by the Mexican Revolution in 1810 and the Bolivarian Revolution of 1812. And that eventual creation of the Latin American nations in the 1820s. So when we take a look at the American Revolution, it has its origins in the British, the French, and the Spanish struggle for control of the Caribbean islands and access to the Mississippi River in the 1750s. So this three-front contest for control of resource-rich lands led to what is known in the United States as the French and Indian War, and to what is known in Europe as the Seven Years' War. And the result of this war was that the French ceded the Mississippi and the Ohio River systems to the British, with the Spanish challenging British claims to the lower Mississippi. Now, it was expensive for the British to take these lands that the colonists thought they deserved to encroach upon. And the main problem for the British was the effective military alliances that native peoples used to confront American desires for more land, especially the defense by the Iroquois Confederacy. Now, in order to maintain peace in the region, the British created the Proclamation Line of 1763. England insisted that Americans not cross the line and wait until native peoples were disentailed from the territory before colonization schemes were implemented. But for Great Britain, it was expensive to take the Ohio and the Mississippi away from the French. It would be even more expensive to take it away from the native peoples. So the British began to tax the American colonies to pay for the costs of the war and to finance their imperial policy. So this proclamation line became the motivation for revolutionary debate. Give me liberty or give me death. How can you stop people who fought in the war from the opportunity to seize the newly won lands. How can you tell land-hungry settlers to not cross into the territory to achieve the American dream of land ownership, precipitating new wars in the process? How can you tell a Massachusetts farmer to not cross into the Ohio so that maybe his son can become a yeoman farmer? How can you tell a plantation owner that his son will not be given a chance to become a master? This line created tremendous problems for Americans, so they decided to cross into Native people's territory illegally. Americans were not about to respect the border Native peoples insisted England should regulate. Americans cried out, "Give me liberty or give me death," and crossed illegally into Native lands. Now that famous saying by Patrick Henry is about American rights to the Ohio. It is about American rights to the Mississippi. "Give me liberty or give me death" is about access to the newly won lands. But Great Britain needed money and implemented all of the famous taxes that the American colonies are going to rebel against. In the process, a constitution would be written guaranteeing Americans access to all of the lands under question. Now, as the Constitution was written, the Iroquois Confederacy offered a model of self-government that eventually became part of the American tradition. The Iroquois model was based on the notion that women maintained rights, they were the landowners, and men were given privileges to rule. So if men were abusive in their rule, women politicked to have their privileges taken from them. And this is the political system. You have those who maintain rights, and they allow politicians privileges. Benjamin Franklin was so impressed by the Confederacy that he housed Iroquois delegates during the Constitutional Conventions and consulted with them as the documents were formulated. So, when we look at the 19th century, we can witness a panorama of social change just by understanding a few facts from the first administration of George Washington and comparing them to selected facts from the administration of William McKinley, who is the last of the 19th century presidents. Now, with George Washington, the first president, there were 13 states. Society was primarily agrarian, and there were five major cities: Boston, New York, Philadelphia, Charleston, and Newport. The family economy predominated. The majority of the population in Washington's first administration lived in isolated rural areas and on farms, either owning or working the land for someone else, such as tenant farming, or working their own land. And slavery was legal. But only adult propertied white males could vote. That was the first administration. So when we take a look at the larger scope and the outline of modern America in the 19th century, we can understand these transformations by looking at a few selected facts from the George Washington's administration and William McKinley's. So when we take a look at William McKinley, when he's president, the last president of the 19th century, there are 44 states now. There is a tremendous growth of cities coupled with the growth of industrial sectors. Subsistence farming gave way to commercial farming and the growth of commercial agriculture. Supposedly, slavery was no longer allowed. Slaves were emancipated. And supposedly, there was universal manhood suffrage. Everyone except women and Native peoples theoretically could vote. So when we look at the outline of modern America in the 19th century, from the creation of 13 states to the eventual establishment of a continental system, we see a process of social change uncovering before our very eyes. And when we journey on the turtle's back between 1780 to 1870, we are going to ask how and why things happened. And we will see that every group that will be incorporated into this new nation called the United States of America will each experience change differently. The Native, the Western and Northern European, the Southern and Eastern European, the African, the Mexican, the Asian, and most importantly, the women. All of these groups are going to have their own versions of what happened in the past. Their histories are different. Their histories are not the same. When we look at how 13 states expanded to become 44 states, we usually call it progress, especially in terms of material changes. However, this so-called progress was achieved at great cost, at great human cost. Some groups experienced progress at a lot less cost than others. So from here on, we need to ask, which way was society changing? How fast did it take place? What was the direction and the rate of change? And there are two broad trends that we need to be aware of as we begin to study the 19th century. And this particular map kind of shares with you the two broad trends. One is the westward migration of populations and the tremendous expansion in size of the country. That's what we're going to be studying in the 19th century. The United States goes from the East Coast to the West Coast. It becomes a continental system. The other, that's one broad trend, the westward migration and the tremendous expansion in size of the country. The other is the increasing rise of cities caused by the rise of industry, caused by the creation of the factory system of production and the dangerous concentration of larger and larger populations on less and less real estate. So when we talk about society, we need to reflect on who is part of the society, who is in and who is out, who is part of the society legally, who is part of the society socially, culturally, politically, economically, who is in, who is out. How do those who are in allow those who are out a chance to participate? How are those who are out trying to get in or trying to get in? And most importantly, let's take a look and understand and appreciate national power. And remember, it was the very beginning of the course I shared with you that racism is an instrument of power used by those in power to perpetuate their power. So let's understand national power. This is why it's so important that we do try to remember presidents and their administrations, not to memorize the names, but rather to understand how they used power to create change. Because national power is central to historical change. What happens at the national level eventually happens to all of us. When we take a look at presidential administrations, yes, it's nice to remember George Washington, John Adams, Thomas Jefferson, but what did those presidents do that influenced change? That's why it's most important to understand the administrations. National power is central to historical change. So when the United States expanded from 13 states to 44 states, we have to realize that national power is central to historical change. Let's realize it. The reason why the United States has a diverse history is the United States does not have a homogeneous history, does not have a history that everyone can call their own. I always hear people talk about our history, our history. There is no such thing as our history. There's no common our history. Why? Because national power in the 19th century created this nation by design. National power of the 19th century created the diversity. National power called for the elimination of the native peoples. National power called for the enslavement of the black. National power called for the exclusion of the Asian. National power called for the subjugation of the Mexican. National power called for the downbeating of the poor, landless, white European. National power told women to put up and shut up. So national power, we need to recognize its unique experience and how it created the struggles for those who were out, the out groups. If we do have a common history, it is that each group defined for itself freedom. And then they pursued the dream so that later generations might have it easier as they followed the path towards liberation. So women, workers, immigrants, African Americans, slaves, Mexicans, Native peoples, all of these groups, poor whites, all of these groups are going to follow a path by which They're going to ask to get in because they are excluded. So the United States offers a dream called equality. And that equality is known as egalitarianism. The United States offers this dream. It is a dream. America offered equality of opportunity, not equality of condition. There's a big difference between the two. Opportunity to move up the social ladder of success, but it does not provide the means by which to do it. So the American dream is related to the Jeffersonian notion of people living equally. Thomas Jefferson desired to create a nation of small farmers. The idea behind the Constitution was basically to free people from permanent involuntary subordination. However, this dream at the outset was, as it was written in the Constitution, only benefited white propertied males, adult white propertied males. So to make this dream come true, the United States needed access to large amounts of land. And if the propertied white male had a chance to move up the social ladder of success, he needed to go somewhere where land was cheap. Basically, the world would be a perfect place for a Republican democracy if every citizen participated in an agrarian world, a society of small farmers participating in a national economy. This is what is called the yeoman ideal. This is where every propertied white male would own his own land, his own tools, his own animals, and everybody in the first and second grade can sing Old MacDonald Had a Farm, E-I-E-I-O. The yeoman ideal is related to each family providing for their own consumption. They're building their own home, they're growing their own food, they're making their own clothing. Is this dream still alive today? Well, I don't know, because I think the dream is related to the lottery, and I hear it's at $1.6 billion now, and perhaps maybe now that person who wins can become president with Donald Trump. Now, this agrarian dream, or this agrarian world, was the dream that was in place by the turn of the 19th century. By the end of that century, by 1900, this Jeffersonian dream changed from the agrarian, the human ideal, to rags to riches stories. In 1800, the idea of becoming an independent small farmer was embedded in those who benefited from the Constitution. So that by 1900, that dream is going to give way to a very harsh reality. Now the average white male worked for someone else. The majority of people did not own the means of making a living, and society changed from an agrarian-based community to industrial areas, to industrial state. But compared to other countries' histories, a significant amount of the American population realized the dream come true, especially in the West. That is why the statement, "Go West, young man," became so popular in the 19th century. It related to moving up the social ladder of success. That frontier, all you need to do is take it from the native peoples, then the Mexicans, and then start your own version of the Jeffersonian dream, the yeoman ideal. So Jefferson again envisioned a nation of small farmers. And so I'm going to refer to that as Jeffersonian ends. The end result is the Jeffersonian yeoman ideal. So this ideal is rooted in a philosophy of freedom known as liberalism. Let's please understand liberalism, because today people are attacking this word, and this is the foundation of the United States. And the United States Constitution are the principles of liberalism. Please understand that. Today's constitutional system we live in, and most of the Western world's system, operates under this political philosophy. So let's take a look at this political philosophy that conservatives have problems with. The philosophy of freedom states, and it's a belief, that quote-unquote man can be trusted to govern himself and deal with his affairs with a minimum of interference from outside authority. Now, left to his own devices, each man pursues his own best interest. And the sum of these individual efforts makes for the greater welfare of all. So people need laws, people need written constitutions, people need Bill of Rights to guarantee their liberties, people need to protect their property, they need to be protected from arbitrary government interference. So this is self-government through representative institutions. This does not mean universal suffrage. It just means self-government through representative institutions. The idea is to acquire political power to carry out political and social reforms through an orderly, legal, peaceful means. Free enterprise and economic affairs, free trade amongst nations. This is the liberalism. And when you combine liberalism with a national experience, with nationalism, it shares a common faith in quote-unquote the people. So government is to rule the people, by the people, for the people. It's to be of the people. Again, this is the notion of liberalism. Ultimately, the people will create a common language. Ultimately, they create common traditions. Ultimately, they're involved in humanitarian efforts. You have to abolish slavery because it says all men are created equal. You have to alleviate working class conditions. You have to popularize education. And you have to improve sanitation. Now, there's going to be a specific response to liberalism, and that's conservatism. Unfortunately, I didn't put that up with liberalism because conservatism, the basic idea under conservatism is wait, liberalism. The change is inevitable, but it has to be guided by those in positions of power. So conservatism doesn't like the notion that liberalism ingrains in people the notion of equality, because the elite want to preserve their status. So they want to uphold the status quo. So conservatism, they don't like the liberal ideas of equality. They don't like the liberal ideas of democracy or national organization because it stirs up the masses. In essence, the middle classes stir up the masses, which can lead to, quote unquote, the fear of mob rule, the tyranny of the majority. So people have to learn to maintain traditions of status quo. Hence, you have to suppress movements calling for rapid change. So again, liberalism is that philosophy of freedom. Conservatism is a reaction to liberalism.
You are watching DHTV from California State University, Dominguez Hills.